Okay. Now, the fifth is a very important point. Information gathered for evaluation, as I said with the navigator on the old sailing ship and the doctor in the morning, if it is evaluation oriented, it must lead to something which I think you said, madam, has to be a decision. See, unless you act on information, it is not information. So if what the nurse does in the hospital every morning is go through, take your temperature and harass you with your blood pressure, pills and things and the rest of it, and then the ward supervisor signs it, uske baad cupboard mein laga diya, then it is not serving its purpose. Okay. Now, I'm sure many of you have friends, colleagues, perhaps family, relatives who work in schools. They spend a great deal of their time marking unit tests. Half the school year is taken up with unit tests and monthly tests. What happens? You know, your sisters, daughters, sisters-in-law, maybe mothers-in-law, do this constantly, and then head teacher signs it, and the marks are registered, and the register is closed. That information is not used.
They become exam-oriented.
No, it's exam-oriented, but the exam stops with giving marks.
Yes.
And maybe a chit is sent to the parents, please organize tuition. Okay, right, something like that. But the teacher doesn't use it, the school does not use that information. So I'm saying, so if we call something evaluation, it must be information that is collected, and we look at that information and take some action. Action, even deciding, say, no action, okay, we can proceed to the next unit is all right. But if many students have not got these three questions wrong after a unit, then somebody has to decide, are they ready for the next unit? Now, in our system, of course, there's not much scope, because the calendar is determined by the... So you have to go to unit 3, even though you know that many concepts in unit 2, which are prerequisite for unit 3, have not been mastered by students, but the system does not allow us. Okay, but we need to be aware of this. That otherwise, see, unit tests, monthly tests have become a ritual. We can use it to... Students who do well, we can pat them on the back, and you know, so the rich get richer, and the poorer students get even more demoralized. What we should do is, if students are going to see that, okay, is there something we can do to help them? Maybe to revise that topic or to hold back the next topic a little until, you know, some background work has been done. So this is what evaluation education should do, if it is to be called evaluation as part of a purpose of activity. So I'm telling you that there are many, many things that happen to us, especially in the education profession, where what was once designed as purpose of activity has simply become a sort of ritualistic process. We can talk more about that a little later. Now, summative and formative evaluation is something I'll talk about later when we come to teachers and testing. This is an expression that was coined some 20 or 30 years ago by somebody working in the area of curriculum development. Summative evaluation is what we're always doing, that is a final inspection. That is the end of the year exam, or let's say when some machinery has been built and the engineer certifies that it's okay. Then I'm sure all of us have been involved in buying flats or building small houses. Finally, at the end, you say everything is okay. You know, the electricity is working and the water is working and the house is ready for occupation. That's what you call summative. It's a final check and inspection type of thing, which is necessary. Everything has to be, like it has to be certified that, I don't know who certified, but all our roads are certified as complete every time there. And then the next day it rains, and of course you have gaddas over there, but some engineer certifies that it's been done according to specifications and so on. That is called summative evaluation. Formative evaluation is this ongoing monitoring. That is, in the process, taking stock and making changes, etc., etc. Now, I'll just put in a term which I'm sure you've heard, something called quality control. I'm sure you've heard this term, quality control. Now, quality control actually started, I think, in factories and so on, where, let's say you have lots of, like, let's say light bulbs coming. Now, you can't obviously check and verify all of them, but they take a sample, a random sample of bulbs or tube lights, and test them. And okay, they have a tolerance saying, say, 1 in 1,000 can be faulty. But they find that they two in the packet of, let's say, a sample of 500 are faulty, then they'll say, okay, there's something wrong with this batch. Okay? And so that will be withheld and others. But this is all after the manufacturing process. That is quality control in the sense that that will not be released into the market because you think there's a problem. Quality assurance is building in, taking observations, making sure that, you know, the voltage doesn't fall, that the materials that are using are pure. That's very important in pharmaceutical productions, that, you know, we don't have faulty drugs coming out. Okay, you can manufacture and then say something is faulty, but then you're still, it's a statistical probability. Quality assurance is where you're constantly building in mechanisms for improving the quality by taking steps as you go along. So there's a term, quality control, quality assurance. And an education which is responsive, which is flexible, which is adaptive, and as we'll talk about in the second part, would be oriented more to quality assurance than quality control. What is quality control in our system? See, by class 8, 45% of our children are chucked out of school. That's quality control. Nikal diya. Then a small elite survives to pay the matriculation fees. Out of them also 50 are chucked out. Quality control. Okay. Now, that is one way of looking at quality control.
And so the cut-off mark for securing first division, second division, third division is also a quality control.
But I'm saying that's one function. What it does is, the people who fail, we don't care about them. What I'm trying to say, it's like discarding. I see, when our education system becomes functioning, there's something wrong. Now with the Right to Education Act and so on, he's saying we can't chuck people out. Everybody has a right to education. So what he said is, we have certain standards. If you meet those standards, we'll educate you. If not, you go. But now we're forced to recognize what we've been talking about since the Constitution was formulated, that students from rural areas, students from backward areas, students from lower caste, in the tribals, also have a right to education. And if they can't meet our standards, it's not because they are stupid. It's because these standards and the methodology are irrelevant. Now, we've been talking about this. Now, the right to education, I think once it gets its teeth, the education profession will have to move more towards quality assurance than towards rejection at various stages, fail, 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 which is what we're doing now. Okay. So these are some general ideas about a perspective on evaluation, which is not specific to tests and exams in schools, which I think is an important part of, you know, understanding this. Okay, now some comments or questions or anything I've said which echoes something which somebody, my colleagues might have said, which you feel is relevant in relation to, again, not so much about exams, but, you know, as
quality assurance,
yeah,
and quality control are not possible in Indian scenarios, because the number of students we have in a classroom, 110 students. 110 students, my friend takes 260 students in a single class, and attendance, taking attendance itself consumes 30 minutes.
Right.
You have only 15 minutes.
No. I'm not pretending that none of these problems don't exist, but we need to have perspectives for looking at it. See, one of the things, please don't misunderstand, because I've been in this trade for a long time. I've had people talking about the fact that there are 120 students registered in a class in rural areas, in high schools, in. But it's also said that students don't come to class, that they're not interested in learning, that they come for the midday meals and push off. Okay?
They come without the textbooks.
What I'm trying to say is, when you look more closely, you find there are strategies we need to find. So we are working under very difficult situations. What I'm saying is, even if we had a small class with 25, we still have to think of new things to make evaluation, to make education more successful for the students who are less privileged. Because our dominant textbook and the
system. I feel that this quality assurance, quality control, and these systems, these are the first world concepts, what is they deliberately forced upon third world scenario.
Okay. Maybe this is something we'll talk over tea. I'll just respond this way. Do you think our railways are third class things which don't have quality control? Every time you get into a railway train, that man wearing chappals and the thing is what keeps us safe. That's not a first world imposition. It's that permanent way people we see on the side, they keep us safe, not the people sitting in rail bhavan with laptops. So if you don't have quality control, every time the Rajdhani leaves Secunderabad, before it reaches the signals, it will jump off the rails. It's a 20-ton locomotive that has to, you know those points where they keep changing that. If that is not maintained, so every day we can have 100 accidents in Secunderabad alone if quality control is not maintained. I agree with you. See, some parts of it are seen as very severe. That's sort of confusing what comes on laptops on the screen. quality, the ordinary medicine that we get. If there's no quality control, you and I will die of diabetes or poisoning within 2 days' time. So that is what, see, the notion of quality control is that. Now, how many sectors we can spread it into, that's a different question. And in our education system, in our public education system, it is difficult. I wouldn't say it's impossible. That what, in fact, on the taxi coming, there's all these fancy schools which have air-conditioned swimming pools, and I haven't seen any one of these schools advertising the air-conditioned football ground. Air-conditioned gymnasium, air-conditioned... No, that is not what makes good education. So, you see, quality is in terms of the... For us, quality is in the terms of the transaction. I'm sure all of you, many of you come from rural backgrounds. I'm sure some teaching still takes place. Are you able to reach students and interact with them? Even if the building is leaking, even if the thing that I... Because I've been humbled by my visits to rural areas where teachers who have shown me that these children have actually learned to write English. They can write 3 sentences correctly. Though that some of them don't have textbooks and so on. Because of the teacher's motivation and that sort of thing. Anyway, I'm not here to preach. We'll come back to this issue.
The question is whether the present evaluation system can be the measure of quality control.
Yeah, that is coming. That's coming. We come to examine. I'm giving you the general concept of quality assurance and quality control. Now, just to round this off, the Open University, when it was founded in Andhra Pradesh, we have the first Open University in Andhra Pradesh. IGNU came after that. Professor Ram Reddy, who was the first Vice Chancellor, actually went as a Vice Chancellor of IGNU. Now, one of the mandates of the Open University is that we will reach all students, even if they can't come to class, even if they don't have educated people at home to support them, through materials, through tutorial centers and so on, so that quality can be assured. Because these students, if you give them an entrance test, the usual Osmani entrance test, they'll never pass. So that is the notion of quality assurance. And the argument I'm making, because my theme is evaluation, is that for quality assurance to work, we must have a sensitive evaluation. Just as a doctor needs to be very skilled in diagnosis to monitor progress, so that he knows, okay, this is a very expensive drug, but it's not working. So he should have A, the skill, and secondly, the honesty to say, look, I'll stop this and we'll try something else. Now that can only be done if he has that diagnostic skill. And that's the argument I want to make, that evaluation, even if the central CBSE abolishes the board exam and other states also, we will still need evaluation because we need to know if students are making progress, and the teacher needs to know, does this student need some additional help? Okay, I'm coming to that. So quality assurance, quality control, I put in that sense. In a general sense, I agree with you, a lot of these things are said, but we got to remember that we can't have a modern system of transport, a modern system of even milk delivery. But as Vijaya Dayaraj said, if there's no quality control, none of us would have been buried long time ago. Okay, so there are certain things in an industrial setup where you cannot avoid quality control. But we have to see what the substance is. Yeah, I think you've captured it well, that we are still have a looseness in education. As I said, we can fail students and blame them for it and not say that the system has to improve. We'll come to that. Yeah.
And the quality of a student cannot be measured by the so-called exam and evaluation system.
Sure, I agree with you. We'll look at that. But we have to see why. Because everybody says, instead, if I don't have an exam, there'll be nepotism. You'll take somebody from your family, somebody from your caste, somebody from your village. We want quality. So we have to make exams good. You see, exams are an important public space for us. But it has been trivialized, it has been distorted. And that is what I hope I can get you thinking about. Because we can't abolish, selection examinations cannot be abolished. The UPSC has to have exams. The IIT entrance exam, the IMCET has to be there. But they have to be much better than what they are now, because they are not performing their function effectively. Okay. Anything else? Okay.
So referring to the same point, please. Again, I want to just say, sir, that very particular, the cut-off mark again, I mentioned it in my earlier class, the same thing. For example, for medical entrance examination, for somebody it is 50% cut-off mark, for somebody it is 70 or 80% cut-off mark. So where is that quality?
Okay, we'll come to that a little later, because you have the distinction between what you call competitive exams and qualifying exams and that sort of thing. We'll come to that a little later, okay? So just remind me if I forget. It's a very important point. I don't want to get into cutoff marks now, because we'll come to a test and exams a little later. Okay, then what I'll do is I'll spend a few minutes sharing what is really my basic academic speciality, which is measurement. Just to give you one or two ideas. It's not going to be technical. See, when we say we measure something, you're all English teachers. What are some of the things we measure? Or let's say we evaluate something. Let's say we evaluate. What are some of the things that we evaluate, either in personal?
Intelligence.
Knowledge.
Okay, intelligence.
Knowledge. Grasping power.
Okay.
So mostly it's memory that we evaluate most of the time.
Huh, no, but okay, I'll come to that. That is in psycho. But anything else when you evaluate something outside? For instance, let's say you want to evaluate a new microwave. No, you can't just evaluate a microwave. What do we need?
We're exposed to something new.
No. Let's say something like a microwave or a new TV set or something like that. And you say you have a choice of three or four, and you want.
On the basis of the speed, let's say if you want to cook some food, in how many seconds is it going to get ready?
You first operate it, then evaluate.
But you can't just, you have to evaluate and say on certain criteria.
Right.
So you have to have parameters, as we call it, or dimensions. Okay, see, you must have perspectives on it. I can't evaluate this table, or I can't measure this table. I can measure its height, I can measure its breadth, I can measure its length, I can measure the thickness of the wood. Okay, now, height, length, measurement, thickness, these are what you call dimensions or properties.
Okay.
So, you see, you can't measure or assess a noun. See, we have to be operating in either adjectives or adverbs in order to measure, because that is where we can do the. Okay. Now, what is the classical definition of adjectives and adverbs? They add meaning to nouns. There, the noun and the verb are somewhat material, because you have abstract nouns as well. But the adjective is one dimension of; it does not exist by itself.
Qualifies the noun.
Yeah, but it is a dimension or an aspect, and it's a theoretical notion. So whenever we assess or evaluate or measure something, that something that we want to evaluate is not material. Then how do you, you can't see it, you can't touch it, then how can you evaluate it?
But the trademark sometimes.
So what is the trademark of intelligence?
Not intelligence.
No, you're
saying. You're talking about the electronic equipment,
yeah.
Sir.
But the trademark, you see, quality assurance, trademark, how was that given in the first place?
We compare it with the other standard ones, the traditional.
Right, so you have to have, but in terms of various parameters.
Yeah.
Now, the problem is, when you want to evaluate or measure or assess, the quality that we want to measure or assess is an abstraction. So we have a problem of how can we measure something that is abstract. Okay. Now, I'll illustrate this by going to the discipline of physics, where we assume that measurement and mathematics and all that is very solid. Now, this is getting a bit oppressive. When do we get our break? Okay, I will go another 10 minutes. Is it totally impossible to have the fan at a low, or is there too much noise?
Some noise is coming.
Noise is coming. Okay, can you?
Okay,
anyway, okay, we'll take a break then. Okay. For instance, I use the medical analogy a great deal. When you have a child or children run the temperature, what do we have to do? Take temperature. I mean, put that. And you have to, small children, to make sure they don't bite it and they don't fool around and, but I'm saying the old days, that they don't push it on top of the tongue and all the problems we as parents have had. That's what makes life worth living in. Now, what are you trying to measure there? Temperature. But what do we actually, when we say temperature, thank God it's only 99.6, what are we actually looking at?
Heat.
Or
We are looking at the mercury in the glass. We stand here, look at the mercury in the glass and say that child has temperature. So you see, this abstract notion of body temperature has to be made accessible through what you call an observable index. Okay? Because you cannot take temperature directly. It has to have a material representation. One more example. You remember the old Traju? When you say something is weighing the spring balance, that something, potatoes 1 kilo, sugar 1 kilo. What you're actually looking at, how much the spring has stretched. See, the stretching of the spring is an index of the mass, as a weight of what you call it. So you see, mass is an abstract concept. Temperature is an abstract concept. So okay, something as fundamental of as physics, you can see that they don't. So when we talk about creativity, grasping power, intelligence, you got to remember that there's even more abstract than what physicists are talking about. So we have to make it observable. So a test of intelligence gives us a chance to observe students behaving in a way which is more intelligent or less intelligent. So okay, they solve intelligence-oriented problems successfully, then we say that is an indication of high intelligence. If somebody is able to answer questions on a passage and, you know, of an, what you call an unseen or unfamiliar passage, then you say the child, the student has reading comprehension ability. Reading comprehension we cannot measure directly. So that's the whole principle, that what we want to measure and observe has to be made observable by using an index. So this is the principle of indirectness in all measurement and evaluation. So see, even in the ship's compass in the old days, and said today as well, what you're looking is a pole star there, but there are some set of calculations you're saying, because of that the ship is here. See, that is also, you're not actually, it's not like God sitting there and saying where the ship is. Using certain calculations on the map you make, so it's only a representation of something else. It's a representation of reality, if you want. So that's important for us, that what we observe is not the real thing. You're observing something which is a proxy, something which stands for something else. Now, this is why this argument, this very powerful central notion in all measurement called validity comes. Because I could be observing the wrong thing. I'm never observing the actual thing because that thing doesn't exist. Okay? So what I actually observe could be something wrong. So which is why we have to keep asking. So is an intelligence test a test of intelligence or is it a test of memory? Many of you said all our tests are. So it's possible that a badly made intelligence test, a student can answer because of general knowledge and not because of reasoning power. And we say a lot of our students get high marks, even first class, because they can memorize and reproduce answers. We're not able to test whether that grasping power is there. Now, how we can do that, we'll have some ideas in relation to that. So that's the point that, so this whole idea of validity, which you'll run into over and over again whenever we talk about assessment, measurement, and so on, it is because we cannot measure the true thing directly. You can't put it on a microscope. You can't open up my skull with a microscope and say, yes, his intelligence is 100 IQ. At least I think I have at least 100 IQ. It can only be by observing my behavior in situations. But when you say somebody is a good leader, on what basis do we say that? Look at his eyes.
His way of talking.
The way he performs, okay? So his behavior in certain, in a variety of situations from which we say he has leadership qualities which are being expressed. So we're always looking for expressions of the qualities we want to assess or measure. So, but if you look at the long, so somebody is, he has all his cronies around him, people who went to school with him. Like our late Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi had all his Dune school friends around him. They were not necessarily the best people. But you can say he was a good leader because they supported him. And we've had plenty of politicians who bribed and got their own, you know, coteries around him. Does that make them a good leader? So, see, we have to say a behavioral good leader is somebody who can accommodate a variety of interests and pull it in. So even our definition of leadership depends on the performance. Not only. Okay, so that's something we'll see when we look at tests. Okay. Now, related to this, there is this notion of reliability. When you make observations, we can only make a very small set of observations. But we usually want to generalize. So, for instance, all of us have this thing of saying, my favorite restaurant or a movie in which actor X, right? Because you say, all right, I saw him in this movie, that was terrible, therefore I don't want to see his movies again. Actually, we make these statements, they're not very rational. Simply because he had a bad role in this film, it doesn't mean that Shah Rukh Khan or whatever else it is a bad actor. Okay? But in a personal space, yes, we do that. It's a privilege. I went to this restaurant and the idlis were sour, therefore I don't want to go there again. Personally, you can say that. But if you're in charge of catering for a restaurant, you can't say, because I had a bad idli, I won't let them give the tender. That comes back to the old thing. That is because we tend to generalize from small experiences. In our personal life, that is okay. But elsewhere, we need to be very sure that I asked the student 2 questions last week and he didn't answer. So he must be stupid. We very easily fall into that trap. We need to make a wide range of observations to make sure that the judgment we come to is dependable. Okay. So I'll illustrate what validity and reliability are, then we'll pause for a few minutes. If I had, fortunately I'm getting a government pension, but let's say I went and I had to earn my living either by being a chowkidar or by becoming a tailor's assistant, the possibility fascinates me. Because my mother used to do a lot of stitching on my wife also does it. Now, if I became a tailor's assistant and one of you came in to get a dress made or a shirt made and he throws a tape to me and he said, give me that. So what do you think? You know, you've all been to this, takes this measurement, takes it around the neck and so on. Now, I can do that, but it's quite possible that to measure your collar, my tape goes like this. And I say 18 inches. And then when your kurta comes, you know, you go through the whole thing. So you see, even if I have the tape in my hand, unless I know exactly how to take the sleeve length for a blouser thing, I should know where to put it. I can't take it this way, I can't take it this way. It's an observation and I'll do it repeatedly. So you see, that validity of my measurement can be wrong because I don't know where to put the tape. I'm putting the tape, I'm not blind, I can read 15.6 inches of whatever is correctly. That is validity. Now, If you ask me to measure something, sometimes I say, do it again, I say 18. That means I'm not looking carefully. Sometimes I'm putting my thumb here, sometimes I'm putting that is bad reliability. That is what we want to get should be consistently measured. Now we can see this when we go to buy vegetables and so on. Sometimes, you know, 1 kilo gives us so much of tomato, sometimes 1 kilo because of, there's a problem of, yeah, but the thing is, we'd expect that one should always give us the same. That's what consistency should be there. So consistency is what reliability is. That comes from, so if, let's say we decided to look at, you know, go to an exhibition and see what the quality of materials, and one person comes back and says, oh, it's a lot of shoddy stuff, nothing very new, the new vegetable market that is all smelling and rotten and so on. Then if that is a valid statement, if you go, you should also say, yes, the cabbages are quite old and the things are not fresh. But if I go to 2 stalls and say, this is bad, but you go and say, look, I found very fresh cauliflower over here and I got some very nice tomatoes, the same people making the same observation, then there's something wrong. But if I go to at least 10 stalls and don't just look at what is in front, because there must be things which have fallen down, and take a reasonable sample, then what my observation and the observation of somebody else should be broadly similar. Now, this is what we talk about when you talk about inter-marker consistency, when you talk about moderation and so on. The marks you give to an essay, the marks he gives an essay, should be roughly the same. If not, there's something wrong. I would say it's something wrong with the criterion system. And it's not something wrong with the person. If that is ambiguous, that thing comes. So reliability has to do with being consistent. Validity is to do with observing the right thing. And we'll talk about that in the context of tests and examinations, evaluation, education, after we've taken a small break. Okay.